Yeah. Hey, so I'm gonna buy something for Carla here in BGC, but got something to eat na rin while I'm here. I love these. And you know what's amazing? When the nori touches the rice, it gets soggy, diba? So this amazing wrapping that just allows you, it just separates the nori from the rice. And then when you eat it, you peel it and you pull it apart, and that's when the nori touches the rice. So you have this crispy skin and the moist rice. My gosh. You know when people say, if we could put a man on the moon, then we can have... No, to me, if we can find a way to have packaging like this, then we can do anything. We can fix carbon emissions. I mean, that's really what I believe. This is amazing. Anyway, while we're doing this, thought we'd make a vlog na rin. What I wanted to talk about here is one of the most common questions I get. Because I'm going to go buy coffee beans for Carla. And that's something I would never have done before. I don't drink coffee. And we just have so much that is not in common. It's different from one another. And one of the most common questions I get from people, like it's a good a few times a year, someone's going to send me a really long message, really private, with a lot of intro and hi, I hope you don't know me. And these are strangers, huh? Most of them are, almost all of them have been strangers. Don't know me, but I just really am wondering, how did you deal with your wife's past? Or how did you get over your wife's past? I mean, the background, for those of you who don't know, because, you know, so many people know me and not my wife. We just lived very different lives before we met. Where I was grew up Christian with very strict standards that did good for me, you know, following God's word, obeying God in these areas, and I'm grateful for doing that. That's not Carla's story. And so people often see the discrepancy between us and say, okay, how did you two do? How did you two get together like that? You know what's unique about her? Because it's showbiz, you know, and it wasn't just like the movie she made or the roles she played, but you know, entertainment gossip and entertainment news would tell you about, you know, the way she was, na baka malakas siya uminom, that kind of thing. Honestly, what makes it unique is the public nature of her life. And so that public nature has obvious disadvantages, and we have to deal with it, you know. She can't do a vlog or a popular IG post without someone commenting something bustos there. But the public nature has its advantages as well. One of the advantages is it wasn't a surprise to me. And for a number of the people who messaged me and asked me that question, it's really bothersome for them because it was a surprise. Because I didn't know this about this person, and so, oh no, parang ganon. And I kind of feel for those people. You know, another advantage that I had with being with someone with a lifestyle like hers is that she's wise to the things of this world. It has no appeal for her. That's part of why I have complete security, you know, when it comes to guys messaging her, sliding into her DMs, as the expression goes. I know, one, she has Jesus, and I know she's like, yeah, you gotta do better to get my attention, you know? You know what I mean? She's not some kind of like, oh my gosh, money, oh my gosh, nice car, oh my gosh, flowers or romantic words. It has nothing, no effect on her anymore. What she needs is godly character, servant leadership, self-sacrifice. Kaya natin yun. The short answer is, it wasn't an issue. It wasn't an issue for us because that wasn't how she was. That wasn't how I saw her. The Bible says that if anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And that's Carla. And so when I got to know her, it was like the person I was talking to on Yahoo Messenger, the person I was chatting with on Multiply, and then eventually on Facebook, that wasn't consistent with what I was reading online. So it was just obvious to me that she was a new person. I even had some well-meaning people talk to me and say things like, you know, if you really want to know kung kaya mo yan, you should look into what she's done before. I know where they were coming from. I don't think it was a good reaction, but I get where they were coming from. And so I did, you know, did some research, stuff I already knew. But that only confirmed further to me that she had changed, because that wasn't the woman that I had met and had grown to become accustomed to and even to love. I wanted to give some framework lang for people who maybe are wrestling with their past and getting into a romantic partner relationship or their partner's past. Siguro, if it bothers you, my first question to you would be, what do you feel about it? What exactly do you feel? When you say bothered, what are you surprised you didn't know this about that person? Are you disappointed that you expected something else? Are you angry? So first identify what you feel. What do you feel about it, ba? Kasi denying that or rationalizing that won't help, diba? The feeling's there, it exists. The second question though is, why do you feel this way? And let me look at some of the most common scenarios, because as I've talked to people about this, and question number one, are you angry that this person was sexually active before being with you? Honestly, I don't understand that one so much. I don't understand this because why would I be angry? It's not like I was the one wrong. We weren't a thing, eh? I don't think she did me wrong by doing that. She definitely did wrong to God. She did wrong to that person, to herself, maybe a few others, I don't know, family members. But not to me. I wasn't her boyfriend, I wasn't her husband at the time. So why would I have a case against her? I know some people who have felt convicted about this and apologized to their husband or wife about this. And I'm sorry that I was sexually active before we met. And to them, I mean, if they got convicted by that, then I'm glad they acted on that conviction. But for me personally, I didn't see that as a thing. I didn't see that as a thing to hold against her or for her to be apologetic to me for. Another one is this. Are you surprised because you feel like you don't know the person anymore? Yeah, and I can understand that. Especially if it's completely the opposite of what you knew about them. Na parang, oh my gosh, ano pala siya? I can understand that. I didn't have that problem. Like I said, her life was pretty public. So I knew what I was getting into. There were some surprises, just like I had for her. Diba? So we all have our own surprises. But here's my question. Instead of thinking about the past, what do you have in the present and what does it indicate for the future? That would be my question. Because if that person is in Christ, has repented, is being transformed continually by Jesus, then you have nothing, well, there's some to fear, but you have that assurance in Christ that they will continue to be transformed. And really, that's all that any of us can hope for. That's the best. You know, there is no amount of past merit. There is no amount of track record, good heritage, pedigree, blue-bloodedness, whatever you want to say. There is no amount of that will guarantee future bliss and success in your marriage. The only assurance we can have is that if Jesus is in that person and Jesus is in me, then we have a shot, you know. Then He's going to work on the worst parts of both of us and help us to stay together. If that person is with Christ, then you're going to make it. And if they're not, it doesn't matter if their past is good or bad, because life happens. Life happens, stress happens, people are going to respond in different ways. And that's why you need Jesus too. Now here's a common one I've heard that I honestly am very concerned with. And it's this. Are you disappointed because you kept standards of purity and holiness, biblical standards, good ones, of purity and holiness, and are you disappointed that you're now in a relationship with someone who didn't keep those standards? And I've heard that a number of times. And to me, honestly, that seems like a very dangerous place to be. Just saying that to anybody who feels that way. Not for that your partner's sake, but for your sake. That's dangerous. And here's why. Now, there's a number of dangerous assumptions there. Number one, I'll do the right thing and she'll do it too. And that's a dangerous assumption because basically what you're saying is my obedience will produce, will ensure, could even manipulate other people into obedience. You know, you don't obey so that other people will obey as well. You obey to please God. You obey because you've realized that that's a good idea. You obey because God moves in your heart to love Him and to love others that way. Even if others do or even if others don't, that's not the issue. And that's the dangerous thing there. For a person to regret their life of obedience to God because someone else did. Look, if you don't like the person, just break up. Just break up, but to be like, oh, I'm so in love with you, but you didn't do what I did. That's weird. All right, that's really weird. The second assumption here is that the benefit of pleasing God is somehow a kind of wish fulfillment. That I'm going to obey God because He'll give me this kind of perceived benefit. And that's not right. The benefit of obeying God is pleasing God. That is why we obey God. Lord, thank you, I got to obey. We're good. And so for me, people ask that, like, did you feel that here you were fighting temptation, and here was someone who was giving into them? And I'm like, that's on her, you know? That's between her and God, and thankfully the blood of Jesus covers over that, and she doesn't go back to it at all. But for me, it's like, no. I did that for me and God. See, remember, with that, if that's your mindset and you're wrestling with that, remember, you're marrying a partner. You're not inheriting a project. And see, some men and women, well-meaning people, Christian men and women, they marry to have a project to work on. You know, they marry to be doing something. Like you have women who partner with guys and date them or marry them even to keep working on them, you know, to clean them up. You know, that guy's not gonna like that. He might appreciate it sometime, especially if it gets you to give him favors, but he's eventually gonna want to be a partner to somebody, not somebody's project. Men, you know, sometimes we do the same thing. The current term right now is white knighting. But dictionary.com defines white knighting as, a white knight is a man who comes to the unsolicited defense of a woman online in the hopes of romantic or sexual favor. You know, another word for that is gross. That's just gross. Don't do that to people. Do it out of love, but not for this transactional thing. And that's what, you know, whenever I hear that question, I'm like, oh, careful, careful, careful. That's a very transactional view of your relationship. When it's supposed to be giving all out. And honestly, here's how I see it. Imagine if, like, anak mayaman ako, diba? And I say, and it's not true, no? But I'm thankful for my dad. He gave us a good life. But not, you know, elite in any means. But imagine I was like that. And I fell in love with someone who wasn't like that. So I could give her more financially than she could give me. It's actually the reverse, no? In a relationship, in actuality. But let's say that was the case. Would I say, I'm not gonna marry you because you can't give me the exact monetary amount? Of course not. I will marry you because I love you. And what I give you is what I have to give you. And I know that what you give me is what you have to give me. I don't ask you for the same amount of me as me. What I ask you for is all. Just like I intend to give you all of me. And so that's what it is. I'm giving to a person. I'm not expecting them to give something back. Just because I give you, this doesn't mean you should give me the same thing back. I'm happy to give you this, and I'll take whatever you give me as long as it's all of you. And that was my deal with Carla, and that's what I'm happy to have with her. Look, if you don't want to be with that person anymore, no one's saying you have to stick it out, okay? There's no merit badge for this. There's no spiritual achievement for that. All I'm saying is if it bothers you that your partner has a past, ask yourself why. And ask yourself what that reveals about you. I guess, you know, in summary, for those of us who are married, all marriages need Jesus. And if you have Jesus, that's enough. Regardless of your past, regardless of your present, if you have Jesus, you're gonna make it. I didn't say goes to church, calls themselves a Christian, has God's princess in or a Bible verse in their bio. No, I mean, they know Jesus. They have faith in Jesus, that their life is being transformed by the gospel. You have that, that's gonna be amazing. Second thing I want to point out to summarize, you know, your past isn't even going to be the biggest issue. Your present and your future. I said that one time. Someone said, how do you deal with Carla's past? And I'm like, oh, I don't have a problem with her past. It's her present that drives me nuts, you know. Just like my present drives her nuts. And lastly, for married people, and if you want to marry someone, I want to leave you with this idea. Well, one of the best things you can do for your spouse is to be the number one believer in the work of God in their life. To be someone who will say, I see it. I see evidence of the Holy Spirit. And hopefully you really see it. Now don't lie. Because you saying that doesn't make it true. But to be the one to say, Lord, show me. Show me what you're doing in her life, in his life. And let me be the first to affirm it with my words, with my actions. You know, some of the worst things I've done in our relationship have come from the times I doubted that God was working in Carla. That's when I said really harsh words, really hurtful words. And some of the best things I've done in our relationship have come from that foundation. When even she herself doesn't see the work of God in her life, and I'm like, no, I see it. Don't worry, you're gonna see it one day. And the great thing is, who benefits most but you, their partner, for the work that God's doing in their life? Oh, let's go na. My partner needs coffee.